Buenas tardes, everybody. Welcome. Good afternoon, and welcome to the NCLR Education Town Hall. Today, we will be talking about the future of Latino education. So as you know, one of every four students in this country is Latino, and in several states, including my own state of Texas, they are the majority. Latino high school graduation rates are at an all-time high. College enrollment has increased dramatically, but Latinos still have considerable achievement gaps as compared to other students. So how do we close these gaps? So during this town hall meeting today, we will be exploring the future of Latino education. This town hall is a meeting this afternoon is sponsored by State Farm and the Walton Family Foundation. So here to welcome you to this exciting town hall is David Hernandez from State Farm, Vice President of Operations. Welcome, David.
Thank you, Paul. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of State Farm, thank you for having me here this afternoon. As many of you may know, State Farm has had a relationship with NCLR for over 20 years. In that time, we have worked to improve opportunities for Hispanic Americans by supporting educational programs that significantly impact the academic and social growth of students, from professional development training for teachers and administrators to programs that empower parents to become more effective participants and advocates in their children's education. State Farm is also the founding sponsor of NCLR's CASA program. If you are unfamiliar with this particular program, CASA is a service learning initiative meant to raise student awareness in community work, increase creativity on hands-on learning, and support teacher development in student learning standards. Parent and family engagement is vital to the successful educational development of our youth. Studies have found that students with involved parents are more likely to earn higher grades, pass their classes, and move on to post-secondary education, offering more opportunities for growth and development for them. Being a father myself, I understand firsthand how important it is to be active participant in my children's education. Even with my youngest being a junior in college, I still get involved in his presentations, research papers, and other reports that he completes. I provide my editorial input on everything from punctuation to general formatting in an attempt to provide him with my business experience as a receiver of information and how to best make it land on your audience. When the kids were younger, my wife and I spent countless hours at the kitchen table and volunteering on school field trips. At State Farm, we take education and development very seriously, both in our communities with organizations such as NCLR, as well as when it comes to our own employees. State Farm makes it easy for employees to participate in our children's or community's educations. The company offers eligible employees one day off work each calendar year so they can spend time volunteering in their community or contributing to educational support. Where I live, in Bakersfield, California, I was able to participate in a California State University program that provided elementary students with basic math skills using monetary problems. The goal was to improve math skills along with some context around the value of money. It was very rewarding to observe the excitement in their eyes as they learned through these examples. State Farm also offers its employees many development opportunities and resources, such as individual development plans, online courses, and tuition reimbursement for employees looking to further their educations. I myself have taken advantage of these by completing two major designations, chartered property and casualty underwriter and certified life underwriter. Those are rather significant in the insurance industry, and several minor designations. Last year, I attended CLU commencement, the Certified Life Underwriter, in my 30th year at State Farm. School is never out at State Farm. We also offer tuition reimbursement programs for online courses through our State Farm University. At State Farm, we believe all children deserve an education that will help them reach their greatest potential and prepare them for life. And we are committed to supporting programs that provide our communities with resources needed to help our children succeed. Thank you for allowing State Farm to be a part of the great work you are doing to positively impact not only the Latino community, but communities throughout our country. Thank you all very much.
Thank you again, David. At NCLR, we value the partnership with you, so we really appreciate you being here today. So before we introduce our fabulous keynote speaker today, I want to remind everybody that on your seats, you have some index cards. So as you hear the keynote address this afternoon from our wonderful speaker we're about to have, if you can write your questions down, and we have members of our NCLR family who will come around and collect those cards with you, and we'll be able to pose those questions directly to the Secretary of Education. So with that, it is indeed my honor and pleasure to introduce our keynote presentation and speaker, Dr. John King, Secretary of the U.S. Department of Education, and somebody who continues to be a very good friend of NCLR. Beginning January of 2015, Dr. King was appointed to oversee all preschool through 12th grade education, policies, programs, and strategy initiatives, as well as the operations of the Department of Education. Prior to his arrival of the Department of Education, Dr. King had served since 2011 as the Commissioner of Education for the state of New York. He was one of the nation's youngest state education leaders at that time of his appointment, and the first African-American and Puerto Rican to serve as the New York State Education Commissioner, and we're proud of that. Dr. King brings to his role extensive experience leading urban public schools that are closing the achievement gap and preparing students to succeed in college. Dr. King earned a Bachelor of Arts in Government from Harvard University, a Master's of Art in the Teaching of Social Studies from Columbia University, Columbia University's Teaching College, and his law degree from Yale Law School, and a Doctor of Education degree in Educational Administrative Practices from Columbia University's Teacher College. So it is again my pleasure. Please put your hands together for our very honorable, distinguished Secretary of Education, Dr. King.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Paul, for the warm introduction and also for your leadership on behalf of the students of Austin. I want to thank all of you for being here, for the commitment that NCLR has had from its earliest days to ensuring a quality of opportunity in education, and appreciate very much the partnership with Janet as we work to ensure that our education system delivers on the promise of equality. Paul framed our conversation in exactly the right way. This is a pivotal moment. And we know that Latino students now represent more than a quarter of our students in American schools. In fact, it can be very clearly said that the success of the American education system is bound up inextricably with the success of Latino students. And there is progress, as Paul pointed out, progress to celebrate. Last year, we had the highest graduation rate we've ever had as a country, at 82%, driven in large part by reductions in the dropout rate for Latino students and for African-American students. We have 1 million more African-American and Latino students in college today than when the president began. We have more students getting access to quality early learning opportunities. So there is good news to celebrate, and yet, at the same moment, there are reasons to worry. We still see significant achievement gaps. Even though the Latino graduation rate has increased very significantly, there's still an 11-point gap between the Latino graduation rate and the graduation rate for white students. When we look at the NAEP, the National Assessment of Educational Progress, we see, again, a significant achievement gap for our Latino students. We know that even though enrollment in college has increased significantly for Latino students, if you look at 25 to 29-year-olds, about 15% of Latino adults 25 to 29 have college degrees compared to 40% of white adults 25 to 29. We know that still too often, too many of our Latino students are in schools where they get less access to effective teachers, less access to resources, less access to advanced coursework. Indeed, our recent civil rights data collection survey showed that in schools that serve large numbers of Latino and African American students, only about a third offer calculus, as opposed to a majority of the schools that have low numbers of African American and Latino students. We know also that we see in places around the country, despite 60 years since Brown versus Board of Education, we have places where students are more segregated by race and economic status than they were even 10 or 20 years ago. Despite the fact that a majority of the students in our public schools are students of color, only 18% of our teachers are teachers of color, just 8% are Latino. We have significant challenges that we must overcome. In too many places around the country, students who are English learners, the fact that they speak a different language at home is seen wrongly as a deficit rather than the asset that it should be. And so we have these significant challenges. And we face these educational challenges at a moment when we also face significant national challenges. I don't have to tell you how problematic the tone and tenor of public discourse has become recently. I don't have to tell you how frustrating it is for the administration that Congress continues to fail to act on comprehensive immigration reform, or how frustrating it is that the courts delay the executive actions the president has tried to take because Congress has failed to act. I don't have to tell you how frustrating it is to look at Puerto Rico, where my mother was born, where I began my teaching career, and see the desperate need for economic development and the frustration that even though we have seen steps to try to prevent absolute disaster, we don't yet see the kind of steps necessary to ensure long-term economic growth. And I don't have to tell you that we grapple with incredible violence as a country. Violence driven by guns, violence driven by hate. I was here a few weeks ago, meeting with LGBT young people, talking about their experience here in Orlando, what happened at the Pulse nightclub, the impact on the LGBT community and the Latino community in Orlando. We have a lot of work to do as a country. But I believe the answer to many of our challenges rests with education. Schools can be the difference in strengthening not only our long-term future as an economy, but our long-term future as a democracy. And I know schools save lives because school saved mine. I grew up in New York City, in Brooklyn. When I was 8, in October of my fourth grade year, my mom passed away. And I lived with my dad, who was quite sick with undiagnosed Alzheimer's. And he passed away when I was 12. And during that period, when he was very sick, school was the only place I could actually be a kid. If not for New York City public school teachers, I wouldn't be standing here today, I wouldn't be alive today. They made school this place that was engaging and interesting and compelling, where we did Shakespeare productions in fourth grade, where we went to the ballet and museums and had a sense that there was a world outside of Canarsie, Brooklyn, where I was going to elementary school. After both my parents passed away, I moved around between schools and family members, but it was always teachers who gave me a sense of possibility, of hope more than I had even on my own, but they instilled in me a sense that tomorrow could be better. And they equipped me with academic skills that allowed me to be successful, but more important than that, they gave me a sense of self, a sense of hope about the future. And so schools, I believe, are part of our answer, and we are at a unique moment as a country because we have a new federal education law that gives us the opportunity to tackle issues of equity that significantly challenge communities all across the country. The president signed the Every Student Succeeds Act last December because he believes it builds on the civil rights legacy of that law. Maybe it's because I was a high school social studies teacher, but I always like to put things in historical context. The original Elementary and Secondary Education Act was adopted in 1965. It has to be viewed in the context of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The civil rights legacy of that law is fundamental to how we approach education. The role of the federal government in education is to advance civil rights, to advance equity. The new law gives us the opportunity to broaden the definition of educational excellence, to hold schools accountable for ensuring that all students have equitable access to advanced coursework, to hold schools accountable for ensuring that all students have the opportunity to acquire the academic skills, not just in English and math, but in science and social studies, that they will need for long-term success. The new law gives us the opportunity to ensure that states are paying close attention to the English language proficiency of English learners and ensuring that students make progress. For the first time, the law requires us to look at the performance of long-term English learners, a population often ignored and forgotten, to focus on the performance of English learners who are also students with disabilities, another population of students often forgotten. The law also gives us an opportunity to move beyond the one-size-fits-all solutions of No Child Left Behind that often prescribe responses to struggling schools that didn't match the challenges within those schools. When a school has a significant growing population of English learners, rather than the one-size-fits-all solution of No Child Left Behind, we have the opportunity to say, no, we're going to make sure that every teacher in the school gets good professional development around how to be successful with English learners. We're going to make sure the school recruits more bilingual teachers to ensure that students can make progress across the curriculum even as they acquire English language skills. Or we're going to change the school to be a dual language school and ensure that all students have the opportunity to be bilingual or multilingual. We have the opportunity in the new law to say, you know what, if a school is struggling with concentrated poverty, then yes, we need teachers to do their best in the classroom, but we also need to support those teachers with wraparound services so that students can get access to health care or dental care or mental health services so that their families can get access to adult education. But we won't be able to seize those opportunities unless folks in this room are active in state and district conversations about implementation of the law. We need you to be loud in those conversations and to be loud on behalf of kids and families who might otherwise not get heard. We need you to represent the folks who may not have the time or the resources to get to the state capitol for the meeting. We need you to be the voice for the families that may not, for language obstacles, may not have the opportunity to participate in those state discussions. We need you to be the one insisting that there have to be translators at meetings. We need you to be the ones insisting that English learners can't be an afterthought in the development of accountability plans. We've got to start with what our English learners need, what our students who are most at risk need. And I know that NCLR is committed to that, and partly I know that because I spent time with Conexión Américas in Nashville a couple weeks ago and saw with Renata the incredible work that they are doing to make sure that all stakeholders in Tennessee are prepared to be effective partners with Tennessee in focusing the implementation of the law on equity. Yes, this law is about more flexibility for states and districts, but the measure of its success will not be how flexible we are, it will be how effectively do states and districts use that flexibility in service of equity. We need to close those achievement gaps. We need to make sure that regardless of race or the language students speak at home or the immigration status of their family, that every student has the opportunity to get the skills they need to succeed in college, in careers, and in life. But I'm hopeful because I'm in a room of folks who are hopeful. And I'm hopeful because I think about that five-year-old who arrives at kindergarten this September. All things are possible for that child if we, the adults, take responsibility for making their school one that is high quality, that gives them access to every opportunity. And I hope that is something that we can do together. Thank you for the opportunity to talk with you. I'm happy to take your questions.
Okay, guys, so if you have questions, we have someone here going up and collecting these cards from you. So please hold them up if you have a question, and we'll have folks coming by to collect those from you. This is a very important conversation. And Secretary King, as we're waiting for the first question, I know in my hometown, Austin, Texas, we proudly serve students that speak over 100 languages in our school. And so that is certainly a challenge that all of us, particularly those who are responsible for the education of our children, need to make sure that we're prepared to ensure that we serve our students well. Okay, here's the first question that we have. What role do you see for the community-based organizations, nonprofits, to help reduce the Latino achievement gap?
Yeah. So there are many important roles. I'll try and focus on two. One is, as states develop their plans for implementation of the new Every Student Succeeds Act, we need community-based organizations at the table in those conversations. At the table with states and at the table with districts as they think through how they will implement the new law. So that sort of advocacy work is critical. But the second is really direct service. And I know so many in the room are engaged in that. But students need, sometimes they need academic tutoring. Sometimes they need mentoring. One of the focuses of the President's My Brother's Keeper initiative, which is designed to support the needs of all students, but particularly our boys and young men of color, is on the power of mentoring, the difference a mentor can make in students' lives. We just, in our Civil Rights Data Collection survey, showed that 13% of our students are chronically absent. That is 13% of students in our schools are missing more than 15 days of school per year. But we know that in schools where kids are connected to mentors, they are more likely to attend, they're more likely to get the supports they need to be in the classroom. And so that direct service work is also critical.
Thank you, Secretary King. Here's another great question. Given the challenges in managing the variety of processes among states as they develop their own accountability systems, what do you consider to be your non-negotiables?
That's a good question.
I think I know who asked that.
Yeah. So, three things. One is that states must take meaningful action when schools are among the lowest performing, when schools have significant achievement gaps, and when schools have chronically low graduation rates. It is not enough for this law to be about transparency. There has to be meaningful action to change the outcomes. So when we have a school that has a graduation rate of 50%, we need to put in place the supports and the changes in the school structure that will produce better outcomes. So one is a focus on changing outcomes through meaningful action. Second, states have to make sure that schools are providing good, clear information for parents about school performance. Parents need to be empowered with a good understanding of what's happening in their schools. And too often, you know, schools will send home pages and pages of information, but not in ways that are accessible to parents so that they can figure out what's going on with their child. I think about our Office of Civil Rights doing enforcement in a Midwestern city where there were very few Latino students enrolled in advanced classes, particularly in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math classes. And we did an investigation. Turned out the information never went home in Spanish. And so for parents who didn't speak English, they just wouldn't know about the program, and consequently, students were underrepresented in the program, and so we required them to change that. So the second piece is transparency. And the third piece is this focus on equity for subgroups. People need to be paying attention to, are our Latino students getting access to AP classes? Are our English learners who maybe are learning English, are they getting, if they have strong skills in science, because they're an English learner, shouldn't keep them out of the physics class or the chemistry class? Right? That's on the school to figure out how to solve to make sure students have access to those opportunities. And so the focus on subgroups and ensuring equity has to be central.
Thank you, Secretary King. Another question is, we have very limited Hispanic Latinos entering the teaching field and profession, especially in preschool and early in the elementary level. What are your recommendations, suggestions to address this challenge?
Yeah. So one problem is resources. And we've got to acknowledge that we have states that simply underpay teachers. We did a study on what we call the pre-K pay gap. And this is particularly a problem in pre-K, we found that in many states, the pre-K teachers are making about 60% of what they would make if they were teaching in an elementary school. Even though we know that there's an 8-to-1, 9-to-1 return on investment of every dollar invested in pre-K. Right? Even though we know that the brain research is so clear on how much students are gaining in those early years, and yet if we under-invest in pre-K teachers, we won't be able to attract the teachers we need. Second, we know that, Second, we know that paying for school is a challenge. President has proposed increasing teacher loan forgiveness so that teachers who commit to teach in high-needs communities would get up to $25,000 in loan forgiveness, because we want to make it possible for folks to choose teaching. And if you become a teacher, you shouldn't have to work a second job or a third job to support your family. And so the combination of making sure we have the right salaries, teacher loan forgiveness, and the last piece is that we need teacher preparation programs in school districts to be intentional about recruiting diverse populations of teachers. And that's got to be seen as the responsibility of institutions. It can't be just up to the teachers of color to advocate for more diversity on the staff. That's got to be the responsibility of every district, every teacher preparation program, every state.
Thank you, Secretary. We sort of touched on this a little bit, but this is an important question, again, coming from one of our teachers. As states are preparing to implement ESSA, what do you foresee as some of the main points of tension and success of shifting to a state-level accountability system?
Yeah. So there's a couple things that I worry about that I hope we can work on together. One is I worry that there will be the temptation of states to build accountability systems with so many indicators and such complicated formulas that nobody actually understands what's happening in schools. Right, and that will distract us from focusing on these important equity gaps. Second worry I have is that, yes, we need to be very focused on the schools that have large concentrations of high-need students. But we can't let off the hook schools that have small populations of low-income students or students of color, but then are systematically denying opportunities to those students. In too many suburban districts and too many places around the country, there may be diversity walking through the school door, but when you go into the honors class or the advanced placement class, you don't see that. And the third worry I have is that too often when we engage in these processes, we start with the theoretical general education student who's not in any subgroup, and we never get to the students who are most at risk, or we get to them at the end, whether that's English learners or English learners with disabilities or our homeless youth or our foster youth or our kids who are in juvenile justice facilities who deserve a second chance. So I worry that states may miss the need to focus attention on the students who are most at risk. And so that's why voices in this room are so critical.
Thank you, Secretary. Another question is, in the last years, we've seen increases in the number of suspensions and expulsions, particularly targeting our black and brown students. What policies and practices should be pushed for the fight against this exclusionary practices?
Yeah. I worry a lot about this. I mean, our civil rights data collection survey showed recently that we see rates three times as high for our African-American and Latino, particularly male students, of suspension, three times the rate of suspension as white students. So we've got a lot of work to do, and that starts as early as pre-K. We know that there are places around the country that are doing good work on this, implementing restorative justice programs, implementing positive behavior intervention and support programs that are about ensuring that we get it to the heart of what might be causing the student misbehavior rather than excluding them from school, which we know is a strategy that leads to the school-to-prison pipeline. But we also need to prioritize our investment of resources differently. Civil rights data collection surveys show that we have 1.6 million kids who go to a school that has a sworn law enforcement officer and no school counselor. Right, what does that say about where our priorities are? We just did a report on spending in states on prisons versus schools. The rate of increase in spending on prisons over the last 30 years is nearly three times the rate of increase in spending on K through 12 schools, and nearly 11 times the rate of increase in the spending on public higher education. We got to invest our resources differently to support teachers in changing those discipline practices.
Thank you, Secretary King. We have actually lots of questions that we're not going to be able to get to, but we are certainly going to hold on to these, and we'll make sure that we forward these to your office, Secretary King. So any final thoughts, closing remarks before we move on to the next part of our program?
Yeah, two things. One is continue to press us at the federal level to make sure that we are fulfilling the civil rights legacy of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, that we are doing all we can, whether it's in our Office of Civil Rights or through our implementation of the law, to get at issues of equity. And then please work with us to engage states and districts in using this opportunity to get at equity. It just is so easy. And you know, yesterday I was in Minnesota. I went to the school where Philando Castile, who was killed in the interaction with police, where he taught and met with teachers, and where he was worked in the school cafeteria. But he was such a central figure in the school. He was a beloved figure in the school. And then I went and met with young people in Minneapolis and talked with them about the challenges that they face in dealing with and some of the community challenges, substance abuse in the community, issues with police, issues with schools. And one of the things I came away with is just such clarity that we will not get to a better place as a country on these issues of race and class and violence and language unless we make our schools places that inspire, engage, and support students' socio-emotional development and that celebrate our diversity. And if we take anything away from the last few weeks in our country, it is that we can and must do better. We must do better. We must create a better future for our kids through the kinds of schools and communities we build. And I'm thrilled that we're able to do that together. Thanks so much for the time.
Please, one more round of applause for Secretary King. Okay, now we're going to move into the audience participation part of our conversation this afternoon. So everybody should have one of these devices if you want to pull it out there and make it handy. So what the first thing I want you to do, and you have a picture on the screen, is the bottom right-hand button is your on switch, power on switch. So if everybody wants to take a minute to turn that on, press that bottom right-hand button as it's shown on the screen. Got it? All right. So what we're going to do is actually move into a couple of questions that we're going to be looking for your response. So here's the first question. Number one, from 1993 to 2013, the college enrollment rate for Latinos went up by what percent? Is it 77%, 133%, or 201%? So just type in your answer there. And if you get the question wrong, you'll be ejected by your chair, I think is what I heard. All right. And the answer is, Peggy? Peggy? 201%. All right. I got that question wrong, too. All right, let's move on to question number two. So between 2000 and 2013, the Latino dropout rate went down from 32% to what? Is it number one, 27%? Is it number two, 20%? Or is it number three, 14%? I know everybody will get this correctly. And the actual response is, I got this question right, I know, 14%. It's fantastic. All right, well, that concludes this portion of the, we'll have more in a second. Gosh. All right, now we're actually gonna get to our panel conversation this afternoon. And it is my pleasure at this point to introduce our moderator for the next portion of our conversation this afternoon. It's if I can please have Olga Aymat, who is the anchor for Telemundo Orlando, to please join us. Olga, welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. What an amazing presentation by our Secretary of Education, John King, right? It is an honor to have him here with us. Before we continue talking about this topic, we would like to recognize a very special person. Johanna Lopez, if you can please stand. Johanna Lopez is the first Hispanic teacher at Orange County Public Schools in Florida to win Teacher of the Year 2017. Congratulations. She's originally from Aguadilla, Puerto Rico, and a proud graduate of the University of Puerto Rico in Mayagüez. She has been a foreign language teacher at Colonial High School since 1998, in addition to her many other awards. So please join me one more time in thanking Johanna for this incredible and so important accomplishment. Amazing. Now we will continue exploring the topic of the future of Latino education through a panel who will discuss different aspects of this important issue. But before, a couple of housekeeping items. First, we will be doing Q&A after the panel. Please use your index cards to write your questions. We will have two card runners who will pick up your cards, and another NCLR staff will be reading the questions from the audience, so I guess you already got a good practice so far. And we will also continue the post questions for you to answer with your clickers. Well, thank you so much. Now, please help me welcome our panel to the stage with a warm round of applause. And I will help you. I will introduce to all of you the members of the panel, starting with Erica Beltran. Erica is a member of Texas State Board of Education and represents District 13. A native of Fort Worth, she has worked in education for over a decade on issues ranging from early childhood education to assessments and accountability. Started her career as a Teach for America Corps member in Houston, Texas, where she taught bilingual elementary school for 3 years. Erica spent 5 years in Washington, D.C., where she worked as a senior education policy analyst at NCLR. She's currently the Tarrant County Program Director for Leadership ISD, a local nonprofit dedicated to cultivating leaders in public education. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
Also, Marcelo Suarez Orozco. Marcelo de Wasserman Dean, UCLA Graduate School of Education and Information Studies, is a psychological anthropologist whose work focuses on empirical and conceptual problems in the areas of mass migration, globalization, and education. His award-winning books have been published by Harvard University Press, Stanford University Press, University of California Press, Cambridge University Press, and New York University Press, and several others. And we also have Peggy McLeod. Peggy is a EDD, serves as a Deputy Vice President of Education and Workforce Development at NCLR. Dr. McLeod began her career as a Montessori teacher, and has dedicated her career to working on behalf of Latinos, English learners, and students with disability. It's an honor to have the three of you here this afternoon. Now, before we get started, I have a question for all of you. So let's analyze this next question. We can look at the monitor. Let me see if we're ready. Are we ready for the next question? Here we go. In your opinion, which of the following is the most important issue facing Latinos in education? Number one, not enough funding for schools. Number two, need for better teacher preparation. Or number three, need for safer schools. Let's see what your concern is here. And that's why we're here, to provide more information. We're going to keep moving forward then.
That's what they think.
Do you see the results? So it's the first one, not enough funding for schools, 53%. Okay, this question is going to be for all of you. This is an important moment for our country since we have the presidential elections coming up. We have a new educational law that needs to be implemented and an unprecedented number of Latinos entering college. What do you see as the number one issue in Latino education at this time? Erica, let's start with you.
Well, first I just want to thank NCLR for the invitation for being here and honored to share the stage with these esteemed panelists. As was mentioned earlier, I live and work in Texas. I represent Dallas-Fort Worth on the Texas State Board of Education. And what I'm seeing back home, and I think is reflective across the country, and the data that we saw, it's clear that we have a significant increase of Latino college enrollment. But what we still don't have is Latinos who are actually obtaining college-level degrees, so bachelor's degrees or higher. And the Secretary of Education just highlighted the statistics. We have 15% of Latino 25 to 29-year-olds who have a bachelor's degree or higher. We know that the data shows that with a bachelor's degree comes a 75% increase in your earning potential compared to a high school degree. And what I see happening in conversations, at least where I'm coming from, is that we're often tackling education at the end. We're talking about, what are the graduation requirements? In Texas, about two legislative sessions ago, we had a bill passed that no longer requires students to take Algebra 2 to graduate from high school. And we have a variety of different endorsements and pathways for high school graduation. And to me, that says that we're not necessarily thinking of policies that are going to open doors. In many cases, we're actually developing policies that close doors for kids and don't set them up and have them ready to actually complete a bachelor's degree or higher. And I think, when I think especially about children of color, children from impoverished communities, we almost have a double standard. We start talking about, we can have two-year degrees, or they can do early college, and they can do career preparation programs. While in other communities, I'll take Dallas, for example, there's a neighborhood called Highland Park. It's a very wealthy community. And I always say, I can guarantee you that the families in Highland Park are not talking about enrolling their kids in two-year colleges. They're talking about enrolling in four-year universities. And so to me, when I think about K-12, we have a very important job of making sure that starting from the very beginning, kids have access to quality education so that by the time they do reach high school, they're actually ready for college and they can decide if that's where they want to go.
Marcelo.
Well, first, thank you so much. Buenas tardes y muchas gracias. Thank you. Thank you, Olga, and thank you to my fellow panelists for this important opportunity to join in this conversation. The great H.G. Wells once said, history has become a race between civilization, education, he meant, or catastrophe. We are now on a race between education or catastrophe. And I think as we reflect on the malaise of our times, on what we're seeing day in and day out, we need to think in a more sober, in a more systematic, in a more rigorous way about what education is all about and what matters most. So, 3 points. First, I think we need to celebrate the important achievements that the data we saw earlier tell us about the long, long Latino journey. I think second, we need to redouble our efforts to do better. And we need to focus on what matters most. I'll go back to the foundations. I think that academic language is fundamental. Maintaining Spanish is going to become equally fundamental. Cognitive neuroscience is completely remapping how we think about the nature between higher order cognitive and metacognitive processes and language function. The most powerful data to date suggests a very, very direct relationship between bilingualism, multilingualism, and the so-called executive function. This is the jewel in the neocortex of the human brain. Bilinguals have extraordinary advantages over monolinguals when it comes to the executive function of the central nervous system. El español es una ventaja, and we need to celebrate that. We also need to build on another fundamental. I was very honored to be able to serve the Holy Father, Pope Francis, on a major initiative on poverty and education. Again, the research tells a very powerful story. The first few years, especially the first 1,000 days, are transformational. They are fundamental for the future, the cognitive development of children. Let me be very clear here. Latino children show unique advantages in terms of the socio-emotional skills that are increasingly required in the 21st century economy and society. So for me, we need to build on these extraordinary Latino advantages. Language, socio-emotional intelligence, readiness, and skill. Latino children arrive in our schools with an advantage in educación. We all know what that means in Spanish. It's not skills for the labor market. They are leaving our school with an education disadvantage. And that's what we need to interrupt. We need to build on the strengths. We need to build on the language. We need to build on the socio-emotional destrezas to really generate the momentum that will take our kids to, as Erica was suggesting, the 4-year colleges that all other kids now are getting prepared for.
Thank you, Marcelo. Peggy?
Thank you, Olga, and I'm delighted to be here hosting and being a panelist with two of the smartest people that I know. I think Marcelo stole most of my answer.
Pardon.
My problema. I think that for me, what's really strange right now about Latino education is that we have kids with these incredible assets of bilingualism, which, as Marcelo explained, confers these metacognitive advantages. I mean, it's even supposed to ward off the onset of Alzheimer's being bilingual. So there's really powerful research showing the benefits of bilingualism that our kids have already. They're going into schools with that. Marcelo also pointed out to the tremendous advantage that Latino kids go into school with in terms of social emotional development. They have pro-social behaviors. They have the behaviors that teachers love that are important in schools. They're going into schools precisely carrying those behaviors with them. Yet, last year, only 21% of Latinos were proficient in reading, which is, of course, abysmally low. Not English learners, but Latinos, 21% proficient in reading. I think the biggest issue facing us right now is leadership, because we need leadership at the national level, we need leadership at the state level, we need leadership in school districts, we need leadership in classrooms, we need leadership everywhere that understands that at this point, we're in a crisis. Latino kids are 1 out of every 4 kids in schools, and yet they are not doing well, and we're at a crisis level. We just cannot afford to lose any more time.
And and this is very important that we actually talk about and concentrate in realizing what the problems are so we can actually focus in trying to make them better. Let's talk about other issues affecting Latino, the education of Latino students. Erica, one critical aspect in education is what happens at the state levels. While federal education policy is important, this new education law devolves much of the responsibility and accountability to states. From your perspective as the member state board of education, what are the critical policy elements that state needs to consider for Latinos or even English learners?
Yeah, it's a great question. So just to give you a little bit of context, I'm sure there are Texans in the room. Texans, okay, yeah. Of course. So in Texas, there are 5.2 million kids enrolled in public schools across the state, and the vast majority of them are Hispanic, 52% of them, in fact. 13% of Texas students are African American, so the majority, again, of our kids are minority students. 60% of our kids in Texas live in poverty. And so this is kind of the demographic that we're working with. You know, when I look around at my colleagues on the state board, I often remind them that the policies we're making really have to be tailored to the students in our schools. And part of our job on the state board, you've probably heard Texas likes to do its own thing. Mm-hmm. We think we're bigger and better than everyone else. And we didn't adopt Common Core. In fact, we have a state law that bans us from adopting national standards. And so part of the role of the Texas State Board of Education is to develop standards. And so we go through a review process every year. The different content areas are cycled through. And part of our job has to be to ensure that those standards are high. This is an equity issue. We have to ensure that every child is instructed in a manner that's going to help them be successful when they leave our classrooms. So that's number one, having high standards and high expectations. What has to go along with that, and we've already seen it in Texas, we changed our math standards before my tenure on the board, but we didn't do a thoughtful implementation, and we didn't train our teachers. And so now we're kind of caught between a rock and a hard place because we have very high standards, we have rigorous standards, but we didn't take the time to train our teachers and have a thoughtful implementation process so that we could get all of our kids to where they needed to be. So supporting our teachers, ensuring that we have strong systems of professional development is an absolute priority. I think another topic that you've probably heard that we're wrestling with now, we have a textbook that is up for review called Mexican American Heritage that is a complete disservice to our community and our history. And when I think part of our job as board members is to ensure that we have a curriculum, that we have instructional materials that reflect the demographics of our kids, that are respectful of who we are as a community, not just as Latinos, but as Texans and as Americans. And so that's something that I think other states will also have to wrestle with. I'm hopeful that this textbook that's up for review for our board will be rejected. I feel fairly confident that it will be. But it doesn't mean that there aren't people out there who are comfortable with this. And so as a state policymaker, I think it's critically important to also ensure that we really do have opportunities for kids to see themselves in the curriculum, to understand their history. I never saw any Latino representation in my experience in Fort Worth ISD public schools. My first exposure to Latino history, Latino politics, was in college, and I think that's just too late, and especially given our demographics again in Texas.
Thank you, Erica. Marcel, another important issue for Latinos is the education of undocumented students, and especially those that are not eligible for DACA. Given the lack of immigration reform in the past few years and also the recent Supreme Court decision on DACA and DABA, how do we encourage young undocumented Latinos to continue their education?
Thank you, Olga. Today in the United States, 5.3 million children, adolescents, children growing up in our country. That's the size of the entire, think of Denmark. That's about the equivalent. The entire state of Denmark has about the same number of this republic of children and adolescents that are growing up in the shadows of the law. They're growing up with an authorized status. So the question is, how do we give them ganas? How do we give them Latino grit? We did a national survey at UCLA, our colleagues, Robert Ranishi, Carola, and I, the first national survey of its kind of unauthorized students. We call them undocu-scholars. And you can go into the UCLA website and download the report. It was an amazing study, and it was an amazing study by how much we learned about what these undocu-scholars want from our colleges, from our universities, from us, really. This is what they clamor for. I'll give you a summary of what came as the issues they wanted us to convey to college administrations and administrators around the country. First, financial aid. You know, no high-income country in the history of the world has managed to do well what we're doing now, we have to do now. We're educating the most diverse population of young people the world has ever seen, and at a time of rapidly growing inequality. And this is a case where the inequality is marked by legal status. And we have very powerful measures from, again, anxiety, stress, depression scales that show the penalty the children and the youth are paying for living in the shadows of undocumented status. First, financial aid, financial considerations. This is the numero uno concern of our undocu scholars. Second, listen to them. Learn about their experiences. Third, whatever happened to empathy in our country? Be empathic. Again, I quote the Holy Father. There are no unauthorized people. They don't exist. There is no illegal immigration. Be empathic. Listen. Put yourself in their shoes. This is what they asked us to do. Publicly endorse them. Support them. Train the faculty. We discovered the faculty in colleges throughout the country. I mean, this is not just, you know, this is not just Florida and California and Texas and New York. This is nationwide. Faculty need to understand the students they're serving. If you don't know your students, let me tell you, you can't teach them. My mother was a teacher all her life. My father was a teacher all his life. This is I have it in my DNA. I know this. This is what the great William James called experience near. Most, in many, many colleges, what we discovered is the kids are saying their faculty members don't know who they are. They don't know about their experiences. Faculty members need to be prepared. They need to be trained. The faculty, the staff, need to be prepared about they need. Another question I have. So whatever happened to respect in our country? Respect. Respect them. Acknowledge them. Provide safe zones. This is what they ask for. Where they can come, where they can talk, where they can share their biography. Give them information. Give them the pathways they need to get the resources. And the most important thing, we need to stop talking trash about unauthorized immigrants in our country.
We wanted to hear more. That's how interesting that was. Thank you, Marcelo. Peggy, some schools say that Latino parents are not
interested in their children's education just because they're not constantly in their school with them, not frequently. However, in many polls, education has emerged as the number one issue for Hispanics. Why the discrepancy? Is it important for Latino parents to be involved in their children's education? I'm sure a lot of people would say yes.
You know, I have to tell you, this is a question, this is an issue that burns me tremendously, because as a former teacher and as a former administrator, I was so sick of people saying Latino parents don't care about their children's education. Where are they? We don't see them come in, and they're just not really that interested in their children's education. And I used to think, first I had to control myself because I would start getting very violent. No violence.
Paz y amor.
But because I knew, and I know, and we know here, that Latino parents are passionate about their children's education. They rank that as the number one issue. We have big disconnect between the way schools see Latino parents and the role of Latino parents. Latino parents may not be able to go to the field trip as a chaperone, may not be able to attend the conferences because you're holding them during the day and have no flexibility whatsoever. And so they look to uninformed people like they're not particularly interested in the education of their children. What we know is that Latino parents, in fact, prepare their children for school. They see their role as telling their children to be ready for school. They put a lot of the responsibility for their children being prepared on themselves and on their children. They stress that to their children. There are ways that we can involve parents that we can really get them into schools, but we really need to see things from their perspective. We need to understand where they're coming from. We have a parent engagement curriculum at NCLR, Padres Comprometidos, that I'm very proud of because it takes the cultural assets of our parents, and treats them as such. We don't treat them as a deficit, as something that needs to be fixed when they come into our schools. Instead, we look at the great cultural assets that those parents bring, and we work with them through our affiliates and let them know what it is that they need to do to be able to go to school. We let them know what a GPA is, what their kids need to be able to do to go to college. And the difference, I've seen this firsthand, I've visited our parents, I've talked to them in Conexión and other affiliates, and the difference in the way they behave and in the way they're able to go into schools is enormous. So our schools need to stop thinking of Latino parents as uncaring and understand that, in fact, they are such assets in our schools. Their children are respectful, and they view schools as a place where their kids are going to gain the skills and the knowledge that they need for life.
Thank you, Peggy. Would you like to add something, Marcelo?
Thank you so much, Peggy. We did the largest study of its kind with immigrant origin students. This was the LISA study, Longitudinal Immigration Student Adaptation Study of the Harvard Immigration Projects, when Carola and I were at Harvard. This was the largest study of its kind, longitudinal, interdisciplinary, comparative. We had Latino families, we had Asian families, we had Caribbean families from multiple points of origin, Mexican families, Dominican families, Asian families, all over Central America. What the data show is that Latino parents have a devotion to education. In fact, it's so pronounced that we get shortchanged for that because we're too deferential in asking for our rights. Latino parents are devoted to the education of their children. Parents will tell you, Why do they migrate to the United States? Para que mis hijos puedan llegar a ser alguien. So again, the schools that don't know how to connect with parents, they need to wake up. They need to get the memo. This is not rocket science. The parents want to be engaged. They want to be connected. You can't make it impossible. You can't take models of middle class parental engagement that don't work culturally. They don't work. And you gotta make them work. You gotta connect. All learning is relational. 100 years of basic research in cognitive psychology will tell you all learning is relational. The kids become engaged when the parents are engaged, when the parents are connected, when the parents are part of the equation. I always say, you know, I remember visiting a school in Lawrence, Massachusetts. 90% Puerto Rican Dominican kids in the school. And I would say, you know, to the teachers, when Maria comes Monday morning and sits in the front row, it's not just Maria. You have her entire family, the entire ambition that brought the family. Have you tried migrating to, say, China, learn a new language, make sure your kids connect with the education? Again, if that's not grit, I don't know what is. Parents, schools need to develop ways to engage parents in the terms that the parents need to be engaged.
Marcelo, and in the meantime, what can the Spanish community do to work towards that? Because sometimes you cannot wait until they come to you. There's got to be something that the community can also start working on.
Well, I was very happy to hear the Secretary of Education. I mean, let's hear it for Puerto Rican sensibility here. He did an amazing job.
Of course he did.
Right? And we have to push. We have to hold them. We have to push, and we have to make, and Eric going to help us here, make school districts understand that they don't need to reinvent the wheel. There are models in our country that are doing amazing work with immigrant origin, non-immigrant origin, first generation, second generation, third generation, Latino children. I'm thinking there are so many models, there are so many examples of good practices. We gotta learn. We gotta take them to scale. We gotta accommodate them. We gotta make them work in other settings. I invite all of you to come visit the UCLA Community School in Pico Union. 90% college going rate. This is one of the poorest sections of Los Angeles. This is the old Ambassador Hotel in Pico Union, MacArthur Park, right? Most of our kids come from concentrated poverty, English language learners' families, new arrivals, very high levels of unauthorized status. 90% college going rate at the UCLA Community School. Again, there are lessons that we can provide. There are toolkits. No, schools don't need to reinvent the wheel for connecting with parents. We very much believe that the school needs to be reimagined and re-engineered as a community place. Mm-hmm. We do all kinds of services, the university does, at the community school. So we need to be more creative. We need to connect with our families in ways that are credible, that are authentic, and you will get the results you want. Again, this isn't rocket science. The parents want what is best for their children. Their parents want their children to succeed in our schools.
Thank you all for this very important information. I want to take a second and turn back to the audience. Are you all ready for another question? Is that time? All right, this next question says, what do you think is the biggest challenge facing schools serving Latino students? Number one, communicating with Latino families. Number two, teaching English learners. And number three, preparing Latinos for college. Interesting. Responding to out of school challenges like undocumented family members and unemployment. There you go. It's the first one. It's communicating with Latino families. 61%. Pretty high percentage. All right, Erica, going back to the issue of governance in schools and states, let's talk about school boards. We need more Latino representation, definitely, on school boards, both at the state and local level, to ensure that the voices of Latino students and parents are heard. For example, while Latinos now account for a quarter of all students in schools, only 6% of school boards are composed by Latinos. Right. How do we get more Latinos on school boards? Yeah, what do we need to do?
Great question, and as I did, you know, responding to the other one, wanted to give you a sense of what this actually looks like in my community. So I live in Fort Worth. The Fort Worth Independent School District has about 86,000 students. 63% of them are Latino students, and we have two Latino school board members. One of them who represents the neighborhood where I grew up is fantastic. I mean, not to say that the other one isn't either, I just don't know him as well. In Dallas, 70% of the students are Latino, which means that's over 100,000 students. And there are three Latino representatives on the Dallas Independent School Board's School Board of Trustees. I'm sure Austin, Paul, you have two. So, you know, just to kind of put that into context, we really do need to have Latino voices at the school board level, at every level of elected office. And I wanted to draw, I guess, answer this question in two parts. There's, you know, if you're a philanthropist or you're interested in launching some, you know, social venture, we actually have some really great programs in North Texas. One of my colleagues who's actually on the Dallas Independent School Board, he's a trustee, he launched a program called the Latino Center for Leadership Development. And they have 14 fellows who go through a program. It's very rigorous. They learn about leadership. They learn about, you know, running for office. They have four candidates. Three of them have successfully won their elected position, one on the school board, one city council member in the suburb of Dallas, and one on the community college board district. And then I'm like supporting them, so I feel like I'm with them. Victoria, who's running for the Texas State House, and her election is in November, and it's a very competitive race. And so that's just an example of the kinds of programs. We also have a group called Battleground Texas. It's partisan, but the idea is to turn Texas blue. And so they have a program called Texas Flip, and it's modeled very similarly to the other one. And so it's a leadership kind of, you know, on the ground boot camp, teaching people about the skills for running for office. So that's one part. But I think just in general, and I think about myself and kind of deciding to run for office, I think we need to change our mindset as a community about what elected officials look like and who they are, and start thinking of ourselves in those positions and in those roles. So I can be very honest with you that when people started asking me if I was interested in this role, I had all of these barriers that came up right here, right? I'm too young. The other person in the race was twice my age, had worked in education longer than I had been alive. And people in elected office tend to be older. They're usually retired. They have more time on their hands, and they like to preoccupy themselves with elected office, I guess. But you know, I thought I wasn't going to be able to raise money. I didn't think I was ready. I thought, you know, this is 5 years away from me. And what happened was that I actually proved myself wrong. I was able to campaign successfully, and part of the reason, despite the fact that I'm actually an introvert and I had all of these other things that I thought wouldn't make me successful, what I had was a strong determination, a vision for my community, and a platform that I was able to convince people to vote for me. And a lot of you in this room have that as well. I'm really not that different from many of you here. And so my challenge to you in the audience, and just as in kind of wherever you live, your community needs to be represented. Our community, Latino voices, have to be there. And I can tell you, in my experience on the state board, when we don't have strong advocates for English language learners, in general. And that's such an important role that we can play for our communities. So I challenge you to start kind of reinventing for yourself what elected office looks like and charting our own path and our own future in that world.
Excellent.
And with the same thought, Marcelo, the presidential race this year has been quite interesting. However, the candidates have not really talked much about education. So my question for you is, what do you see in the educational landscape in the next few years?
So first, Eric, I had a depressing thought that I've been in education three times longer than you've been alive.
I'm not as young as me. I look.
Thank you, Olga. I think that, let me make a very, very clear point here. Given the demographics, we all know the demographics, there is no happy American future without a happy future for Latinos in education. Mm-hmm. Just the math doesn't work.
That's true.
This is what we are seeing moving forward. The rate of US-born Latino children will continue to grow. Today, half of all children under five are minority children. This has never happened before in the history of the world. This is the first high-income country that is in the process of a massive demographic shift. This is all driven by Latino babies, by Latino births. We have historic levels of inequality. We have an unforgiving global economy that is asking more of education than ever before in human history. And we need to do many things, and we need to coordinate them clearly and purposefully. First, I would say this. For a while, what we need to do is we need to put high-stakes testing in their place. High-stakes testing are hurting English language learners. The data on this are overwhelming. They're not meaningful measures. They don't tell you anything of use or of relevance. It's a kind of a mini torture for the kids that become very dispirited and discouraged. We need to do better harnessing two pieces of the Latino experience in the US that, again, the research show, the data of this are overwhelming. Marta Tienda at Princeton and Grace Gale, her colleague at the University of Pennsylvania, have shown very clearly, Latino optimism is an asset. We need to work with that in education. Again, I come back to Ghana's. I come back to building upon our framework for education, which is very complex, and it has more than just, when you think about education in the 21st century, I talk to politicians all over the country and all over the world. They think about the cognitive and metacognitive skills that will be required in a knowledge-intensive economy, full period. That's not even the start of the conversation about education. When the Greeks first thought about education, they thought about, right, what's the Greek word? Eudaimonia. The flourishing of the human child, bringing out the full potential of the human being. When the great John Dewey imagined a democratic society qua education, Dewey thought about citizenship. We don't talk about education for citizenship. Part of why we're in this bizarre moment in our politics, I think is in part of an indictment of the failure of our thinking about education as fundamental for the creation of citizens. Mm-hmm. You know, today the secretary spoke very eloquently, and he mentioned the Civil Rights Act. And it's very interesting Johnson, President, when he was LBJ, when he was writing the Civil Rights Act, he had a very powerful sentence. He said, "Tyrants like, you know, ignorance. Education is fundamental for citizenship. We need to reimagine and we need to re-engineer an education that is more balanced, that it is for the 21st century labor market. It's more interconnected, our economy, our world is more miniaturized, it's ever more fragile. We're all in this together. You can't build walls anymore. That doesn't work. That's not how the world is wired. Moving forward. And you can't put the genie back in the bottle. We live in an economy that is completely interconnected. We live in a culture that is completely interconnected. We need to re-engineer education for that world, for the new demographies of the 21st century, for the new technologies of the 21st century, for the new economies of the 21st century. And the entire world is looking at us. Let me share something with you. Two-thirds of the children, you take Rotterdam, Amsterdam, and The Hague. Rotterdam, the largest port in the heart of Europe. Two-thirds of the children that woke up this morning in the Netherlands to go to schools in Rotterdam, in Amsterdam, in The Hague, come from non-Dutch immigrant origin homes. You go to Stockholm in Sweden, 40% of the children in the Stockholm schools come from non-Swedish immigrant origin homes. I go to Rome to, we've done several projects for the Pontifical Academy, the Pope Francis's Scientific Advisory Board. 40% of the children in the Italian schools now come from non-Italian immigrant origin homes. So, you know, this is Orlando, this is New York. Half of all children in the New York City, I was a professor at NYU for many years, half of all children at the New York public schools today come from a household where the head of household is foreign born. We heard the data from Fort Worth. We know the data from our cities. 75% of the children in the LAUSD, the second largest school district in the nation in my city, Los Angeles, 75% of the children in LAUSD today are Latino. So we need to open our eyes to the new demographies, the new technologies, the new economies of the 21st century, and we need to build on strength. We need to stop all this disparaging talk of inadequacies, of we don't have, pobrecito. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Marcelo. Peggy, let's talk a bit about the new education law, the Every Student Succeeds Act, which puts the onus on states to develop and implement new accountability systems. As states move toward the implementation of this new education law, what is the National Council of La Raza doing to ensure that states do a good job of educating Latinos and English learners?
Sure. Let me be brief, because I know we want to go into some questions and answers at this point. But basically, NCLR is in a really unique position. We worked really hard to ensure that the new education law continued equity for Latinos and English learners. We're particularly pleased with the provisions for English learners. And we're in a unique position because our policy and programs work together. And so as we move from a focus at the federal role, to a focus on states and how they're going to develop accountability plans, we're going to be working with the many assets and resources that we have in states. So I'll give you a couple of examples. We have the National Institute for Latino School Leaders. It's a fellowship program that to date has trained about 40 fellows. We're going to be taking those folks all over the country, and they're going to be working at their state level to make sure that the state plans, the accountability plans, are very strong. We also developed last year a new program for parent leaders. And so we're going to take those parent leaders who are just beginning their advocacy efforts and put them as a resource You'll be seeing lots of webinars from us. You'll be seeing downloadable material. So check our website and look for those. And we will be working, we'll be doing this work through our nearly 300 affiliates across the country.
Yes, a very busy and positive year.
Yes.
That's very good. Do we have time for another poll? We do. Okay. So let's do another poll at this time. Given the state of Latino education, which of the following should be priority for the next president of the United States? Number one, ensure that each child in the United States has access to early childhood education. Number two, all children have access to a well-rounded curriculum that includes art, music, and technology. And number three, make higher education affordable for all Americans. No pressure for the next president, right? We see number three, make higher education affordable for all Americans. Okay, and this is the last question, and it goes.
I think we're going to go into.
We're going to go ahead and finish?
Yeah.
Okay,
we're
well, we don't have any more time, so we wanted to thank all the panelists for taking some of that busy time of your schedules to be here with us, providing us with all this incredible information.
Oh, no, we do have 10 minutes for Q&A.
Oh, we do?
We do,
okay.
And I have some questions available
okay.
here.
Okay, not a problem.
Not a commercial break yet.
We're going to pause.
Not off the hook.
Thank you. And the questions are not specific to any of the panelists, so whoever feels compelled to answer, please do so. The question reads, how do you think we should be defining college and career readiness within an ever-changing global economy?
That's a good one.
So either one of you? Yes. Any one of you?
Well, I'll say the most obvious, which is learning to learn, that is, the metacognitive. This is where the language really makes a difference, is going to be the new gold standard. Cognitive and metacognitive capabilities, skills, competencies are increasingly going to be what move the needle. You know, you all have phones where you can access information, you can access algorithms, you can so much that is rules-based in the 21st century economy will move on and kind of enter the archaeology of how we think about the economy and the society in the 21st century. What will remain are these skills, competencies, sensibilities, where learning how to learn, where learning how to solve problems, where communication, again, socio-emotional intelligence, the so-called pink, what are they called, pink color or soft skills, are really what will make a difference. Rules, anything that is rules-based as a category of labor will disappear. So you think through what that means. It means that really we need to cultivate these sensibilities that enable us to reflect on our learning, to improve on our learning, to solve problems, to communicate, to work with people that are different than ourselves. You know, that's again a skill that requires some empathy and some socio-emotional intelligence. Where are you coming from? What do I need to know to sort of be, to take your perspective? I would say that those are the issues that are going to come to the increasingly to the foreground.
I will direct the next question because I think it's fitting to Erica Beltran. Aside from the challenges of implementing new accountability systems, what do you think should be done at the state and local level to address curricular frameworks and materials that currently lack cultural and linguistic competence?
Yeah, that's a critically important question. And you guys, if you want to chime in, please feel free, because it's tough. You know, I think in Texas, again, before my tenure on the board had approved a course in ethnic studies that included Mexican-American studies, African-American studies, Native American, gender studies. So Texas has this. We have policies in place that allow school districts to do it at the state level. What we haven't necessarily seen a lot of is actually school districts taking it off the shelves and saying, we are actually going to make this a priority and offer the courses. And so I think there's a lot of work in local communities in particular, in my context anyway, where communities really need to be vocal about wanting to have that kind of curriculum and demanding that from the local school board and the local school district. And I think, you know, from you know, nonprofits and other community members of, you know, helping us think through what that curriculum will look like. Our standards for, it's called special topics in education, sorry, in social studies in Texas, and the standards are maybe 12 standards. They're very broad. And so there's a lot of kind of, you know, creativity that can be involved there. And I, you know, I would hope that, and it could go awry, of course. But, you know, what I would hope is that we could build partnerships with, you know, institutions of higher education or other professional groups of teachers who can build curriculums that can then be implemented in local school districts and classrooms.
Can I just say that I think Texas is a really good example of what happens when you don't have high standards, because it is a framework. There are standards, very clear standards in other areas, but the ethnic study standards are just very, very broad, and so that's why there's this controversy about the Mexican American Studies textbook, which is horrible and terribly inaccurate. And so I think it points to the importance of really of maintaining high standards in states.
Thank you. And the next question is actually for you, Dr. McLeod. As a parent, what would you say are the top three issues I should be aware of as I try to participate in a process that will impact my child and his education?
As a parent, I think there's some things that parents need to understand. One is that they have a lot of power and that they can go into schools and should go into schools and demand that schools do teach their children well. I think parents need to, if they can, go to schools and demand that schools communicate with them in their language, whatever that might be. Part of the reason why there's such poor parent engagement across this country is because things are sent home in English. And, you know, I don't read English. I might not even read Spanish. So that has to change pretty dramatically. And then I think that parents need to arm themselves with the resources that they need to be able to speak to their teachers, the teachers of their children, and ask them important questions and ask them what that curriculum looks like, what those materials look like, and if in fact those materials are culturally and linguistically relevant for Latino students.
And this will be the final question. I think it's appropriate for all three of you. And it deals a little bit with how we portray Latino students. And the question is, how do we shape a different narrative for Latinos in our school system?
So I think that, thank you, Peggy, I'll go first. I think that what we need to do is we need to lower the temperature. I think we need to lower the temperature. You know, I think I feel like a fireman. I go in to sort of put the fire out when, you know, I'm asked to talk about issues of immigration. We need to lower the temperature, and we need to normalize what is happening today, especially around issues pertinent to immigration. You know, we've been there, we've done that, right? 100 years ago, the narrative about newcomers was alarmingly congruent, aligned with what we're hearing today. The next time you're in New York City, go to the Tenement Museum in the Lower East Side. Go to Ellis Island and look at the portraits in the media about Eastern European Jews coming to our country, about the Irish coming to our country, about the Mediterraneans coming to the United States. Go read, there's a fabulous archive. I took Lawrence O'Donnell and the MSNBC to do, we did a special on this. And it's striking. It's the same narrative. is a narrative they're never going to assimilate. They're all criminals, this kind of atavistic thing that we see. There was a especially vicious anti-Jewish and an anti-Catholic virus. Let me tell you this. All, 100%, all members of the United States Supreme Court today are either Catholics or Jews. If a dean 100 years ago would have stood up in New York City and said, relax, they're going to do very well in our country. Their children are going to learn English. They're going to build a democracy. They're going to build the greatest economy the world has ever seen. People would say, well, there goes the economic. You know, they're in Never Never Land. Right? Now, so been there, done that. We need to lower the temperature. That's the most important thing, I think, we in our respective voices, as professionals, as scholars for me, as citizens of the nation, this is the most important challenge we have. This is a new issue in many parts of the world, not so in the United States. You know, Spanish was spoken here, not too far from where we are. Before John Harvard sailed to the Massachusetts Bay Colony. There's nothing foreign about Spanish in America. So lower the temperature. I think that's numero uno in my world.
Yeah, that's hard for me in particular. I think especially when we're in an environment where we're often, it requires kind of a knee-jerk reaction. It's either you stand up or nothing is said, you know, oftentimes in the world where I live anyway, where I feel like I have to be, and maybe this is, you know, a different angle, but just we also have to own our own stories, right? We have to say, this is not acceptable, and we have to build our own narrative and redefine for others what it means to be Latino, a Latina student, what it means to be, you know, living in Diamond Hill in Fort Worth, Texas. It doesn't mean that we're criminals. It doesn't mean that we have a hopeless future. That actually, you know, we have to build our own story. Someone else is telling our story right now, constantly, and it's on us to redefine it and tell it ourselves.
Amen.
I wanted to thank our panelists one more time for sharing all the expertise, and we learned a lot today, right? We did. Thank you so much for sharing all this and addressing all these important issues that are affecting our Latino community. I want to thank all of you also for participating with us and to let us know exactly how you feel and to prioritize this important issue. Thank you so much. Have a nice afternoon.
You did a good job.
Oh, you too.